Like the congregation to please rise. We'll turn in our bulletins and sing our opening hymn, The Old Rugged Cross. And best. a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross. My trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange. Someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. In holy baptism, Clint was clothed with the robe of Christ's righteousness that covered all his sin. St. Paul says, "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his." As we say on Easter, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Let us pray. O God of grace and mercy, we give thanks for your loving kindness shown to Clint and to all your servants who, having finished their course in faith, now rest from their labors. Grant that we also may be faithful unto death and receive the crown of eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the readings. Our first reading is a favorite, Psalm 23. We're going to read that responsibly. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He restores my soul. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Our first reading comes to us from Isaiah, the 65th chapter. This is one of the most beautiful descriptions of the resurrection in the Old Testament. And you'll recognize many of these words. It says, "For behold, I create a new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come into mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in that which I create. For behold, I create Jerusalem to be a joy, and her people to be a gladness. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and be glad in my people. No more shall be heard in it the sound of weeping and the cry of distress. Nor more shall there be in it an infant who lives but a few days, or an old man who does not fill out his days. For the young man shall die 100 years old, and the sinner 100 years old shall be accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall the days of my people be, and my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain or bear children for calamity, for they shall be offspring of the blessed of the Lord, and their descendants with them." And it looks like there's a misprint in the bulletin, so I'm going to pull out the Bible and to read the rest of it. It says, "Before they call, I will answer. While they are still speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb will feed together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. But dust will be the serpent's food. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I'm going to do a little message for the children and youth that are here today. That particular reading is kind of unusual because it talks about people dying at 100 years old, and I thought in the resurrection there was no death. Well, what Isaiah is describing there is not that we would die in eternal life. He says that if you were to die at 100 years old, you'd be accursed. That means you wouldn't be a believer. And your great-grandpa lived to 96. And he's saying if you didn't live to 100, that wouldn't be anything. So someday when we're resurrected, we will live not 100 years old, but like the years of a tree. Now, how old does a tree live to? A long time. In fact, some of us never see a tree die except that it would get diseased. How old are the redwoods? Some of them they think are around 4,000 years old. So can you imagine living that long? Nope, that's a long time. But he's saying that they will live not 4,000, but forever. And the oldest thing we know of on earth is a tree, and so that's why he describes it that way. That's hard to imagine, but we will live forever and ever, not just up in heaven, but with real bodies. We'll have hands and feet, eyes and ears, and we'll live for eternity. It's a real beautiful thing that we will get to enjoy. Well, thank you for listening a little bit. We're going to go to our next reading, which I don't think is in the bulletin. So the next reading is from 2 Timothy chapter 4. It's in my original bulletin, but not in the one that got printed. So this reading is what I'm preaching on, so you have to hear this. Second Timothy chapter 4, and we're going to look at verses 6 to 8. It says, if you point these things out to the brothers, you will be a good minister of Christ. And then, helps if I read the right verse. For I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time has come for my departure. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I have another bulletin that's actually correct, so I'm going to use this one. Let's join in singing the hymn. That is printed there, How Great Thou Art. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, I hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Thank Son not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Our next reading comes to us from John chapter 11. And when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him. But Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We'll join in singing Amazing Grace, hymn 744 together.
His grace will lead me home.
Yes, when this flesh and heart shall fail, and mortal life shall cease, amazing grace shall then prevail in heaven's joy and peace. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Grace, peace, and mercy are yours from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Stuart and Julie, Scott and Cindy, Anita, Brett, and Lisa, Jane, looking for you. Over there, okay. And all of your families, friends and relatives, and also our fellow church members, brothers and sisters in Christ, to Clint, and of course, there's many watching online that wanted to be here today. We're glad you're able to come, even through the snow and ice, in that way also. Today, for this message, I want to use the verse from 2 Timothy chapter 4 about fight the good fight of faith. What a beautiful verse. And as I was getting ready today, I realized the entire book would be good for you to read for today. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but just a few verses that are especially appropriate. And the reason is because your dad, your grandfather, your great-grandfather, your friend, your neighbor, fellow church member, received grace from Jesus. And that's what the book is about. It's about Paul. He's talking to his spiritual son, Timothy, and he wants to make sure that he continues in the faith and continues his work. So he starts out the book, "You've got grace, Timothy. Family, you got grace. You've got the same grace that Clint had. He was loved by Jesus, so are you. Take it, it's yours." And maybe you knew this, maybe you didn't. I think you knew it because he usually said, he prayed for all of you. Do you realize that? Pray all the time. When I'd come over the house, we'd pray. We'd pray for everybody. Maybe not everybody by name, but pray for all of you. Why? Because he cared about you. He wanted to make sure you had the same faith that he did. And the book starts out this way. "For this reason I remind you," so Paul's talking to Timothy, "I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is yours in through the laying on of hand. For the Spirit of God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline." He's basically saying, Timothy, you got a gift. Go use it. Don't be timid. Use it. Your dad, your grandfather, your great-grandfather had some amazing gifts. And he had some amazing stories when he was a soldier in the war. I often said he actually saw the things of the history books and took the pictures for the books. And then, of course, all the stories could then be continued to be shared. He worked very hard, had fun. And Paul writes about the soldier life. He says this in 2 Timothy chapter 2, "Join with me in suffering like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No one serving as a soldier gets entangled in civilian affairs, but rather tries to please his commanding officer. Similarly, anyone who competes as an athlete does not receive the victor's crown except by competing according to the rules. The hardworking farmer should be the first to receive a share of the crops. Reflect on what I am saying, for the Lord will give you insight into all this. Now, if I were to do a devotion on this with your dad, you know what would happen? He'd tell me three stories after we got done about how he was a soldier, just like the reading says here. And then he'd talk about all of you that are being athletes right now. And then we'd end up talking about planning something. Because it talks about being a farmer. And the reason is because it says the Lord will give you insight into this. And if you understand those three illustrations, you understand what Paul's telling Timothy to do. Clint took life very serious. He worked very, very hard. And I think a lot of that came from being a soldier and all the things that came with it. And he took life hard in the sense, I almost wonder if he read Benjamin Franklin, because a lot of what he did in his life resembles what Franklin said. If you get a chance, read some of his works, but I'll just read a quote. Don't get stuck living a mediocre life. Don't let your burdens and challenges take away your passion. Live your years fully so that when you look back, you can smile. Like I said, he had an unbelievable work ethic. In fact, he was very proud, not just of himself, but of all of you and your jobs. Because when I went over and after our devotions, he'd tell me what everyone's job was and how much they were making. You see, he understood the way of the world. To do well in this world, you gotta work hard. But at the same time, working hard did come in order. He knew this. It's Jesus first, spouse, family second, and working hard, job, business third. Although, I think if you're honest, sometimes the working hard came first and maybe got mixed around a little bit. And I actually talked to all siblings on some of the memories of him, and I think some of your best memories are when he was working, or some of you called them nightmares, and because they were so long and hard and not getting to eat and having to sneak out and all that goes with that, the strange schedules. But why is that? Why did he do that? Because he understood that as a soldier, you had to work hard. You had to work for that commanding officer, and then you would do well. Same way with athletics. If you want to be a good athlete, you got to train hard. Otherwise, it's not going to go well. And his point here is the same as a Christian, except that's supposed to be number one. You train hard as a Christian so that as we're competing through this life, that in the end, we will have eternal life. It's not that we earn it. It's that Jesus already earned it for us, and now that we get to follow Jesus, we're like a soldier in the Lord's army. I guess we should have sang Onward Christian Soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. We work hard for him because Satan is working hard to get us out of following him. It does. It's tough to follow Jesus because everything else seems to distract. I heard some stories about golf, and golf is good, but again, it's supposed to be third, Jesus first, and then we get to play golf. Then chapter 3, Paul continues with writing against false teachers because he knew that it would be easy to fall away from Jesus. And your dad, your grandpa, your great-grandfather hated false teachers. Did you know that? And especially if they were a politician and they were teaching things that said abortion's okay, or that marriage is not between a man and a woman, he'd get really mad. And he's right to, because that's false teaching. That's not the way God designed things. And you know what despised him also, just like this reading? He despised when churches didn't take their job seriously and pastors didn't work hard. He believed that we ought to teach the Word of God and get it out and get it right. Now, I know politics can go way beyond those simple teachings, and obviously, I'm not up here going to say all Democrats are not Christians. There's some that are. But on the same way, on the other side, he would be against any Republican that wasn't teaching the Word of God right either. Even though he'd say more, they usually get it right more often. It's very principled. He was not perfect, no. Even St. Paul, the chief of sinners though I be. But Clint was forgiven in Jesus. Listen how chapter 3 continues. But mark this. There will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient of their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, and I could keep reading. I don't know how many times Clint told me he was ready to be done with this world because of exactly what you just heard. You've got it tougher. I've got it tougher because we continue to live in a world that isn't following Jesus, that's following its own ways, where everybody does what everybody wants to do by themselves. And so Paul is writing Timothy because he's about to leave this earth. And he wants Timothy to stay strong despite it. I don't think your dad, grandpa, great-grandfather would ever claim that he was better than Paul. But I think in a little sense, he tried to live as a layperson, as one who valued Jesus, and he wants his family to value him too, even after he's gone. And of course, he would tell you to work hard and to have fun, but always come back to what's truly important. One of the things that he was always frustrated that he couldn't get to church. I don't know if you know this. You probably did. He would come to church probably when you didn't want him to come to church. He came to church sometimes even in these last couple years when he shouldn't have been coming. He also went to Fairway when he shouldn't have been going to Fairway, and a lot of other things. But the reason is because it was important to him. And I told him, you realize, Clint, pastors do have cars so we can come see you. Because he knew it was important to get the Lord's Supper and hear God's word. And that, I believe, is his prayer for all of you as well. That Stuart and Scott, Nita, Brett, Julie, all of your families, friends, neighbors, that you do take the effort to get to church. He always wants you to be here and to hear God's word, even though it takes effort. That's just crazy, some of the stuff he did. But at the same time, it's that ethic that he wanted to be there. Which brings us to the reading. I finally get to our reading for today. He says, "For I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near." Now, one of the things that your dad liked to do is he liked to get some insight in the readings. Wanted to make sure, Pastor, you point out something new in there. Well, what's Paul saying, a drink offering? Well, the answer is that back in the Old Testament, that they would offer sacrifices, they would offer burn offerings and sin offerings, but they would also offer thank offerings. And it could be food, it could be a drink that was given, and it would be poured out to God. Because after all, when we eat, we're going to enjoy a really good meal down on the other end in a little bit. It'll be good, yes. But when you enjoy a meal, you also want to enjoy it with God, too, because we're thankful. And so that's why when we take the Lord's Supper, you receive Jesus' body and blood, but it's like a meal of us and God. Well, the drink offering, Paul realized he was at the end of his life, and he was offering himself, poured out. He's going to die, but his best. And so he's telling Timothy this. I'm being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. The Greek word literally means something like, it's going to happen really quick. It's near. I've caught the good fight. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith. Like I said, Clint wasn't perfect, but he's forgiven. He had the grace. Neither are we. Neither am I. You see how my bulletin didn't... I even mess up in the middle of the service. But Jesus forgives. And we go on fighting the fight of faith. And we give our lives to him. Paul's point, he's going to die, but Timothy's going to go on. And he's challenging Timothy, you go fight the good fight of faith too. You be the good soldier. You be the athlete. Yeah, some of you are athletes right now on the field, but don't just be an athlete on the field or the court, but be an athlete for Jesus. Some of you are soldiers, but he's saying, don't just be a soldier there, but be a soldier of the cross. Fight for him. And then the closing verse, now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. Well, what day is he talking about? Right now, Clint's in paradise. He's in heaven with the Lord. We know that. Today you will be with me in paradise, a verse we quote from Jesus when he was on the cross. But we know that the body is going to remain here on earth, or cremains, or in the ground. But on the last day, that soul and that body will be reunited. You wonder, how is he going to put that back together again? But he will. And he's going to raise it, so he's not going to live to 96, not to 4,000, but to forever. And he's not going to be frustrated with his arm anymore. He's not going to be diving at, what did we figure that was, 80? Mid-80s. He'll be diving at 4,000 and 6,000, 10,000 years. It will go on forever. All of us will. That is the crown of righteousness. And it's not just for me, Paul says, but it's also to all who have longed for his appearing. So my challenge to the rest of you today, if you learn anything from Clint, learn from his longing for Jesus to come back. Long for that because it'll be yours too as you trust in him. It's my prayer today. Clint, not perfect, but he's forgiven and he's with the Lord now. I'm not perfect, you're not, but we have all have grace and we're called to be soldiers of the cross, athletes competing in the games that Jesus has given us to do. And even learning from that farmer of how that work is done, and we follow him. So continue with Jesus. He will help you through, not just this day, but all through life. Fight the good fight of faith. Amen. Now may the peace that passes all understanding keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We're going to continue now with the Apostles' Creed. It's on page 7 in your bulletin. If you're able, would you please rise? God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ, living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I want to include also an additional prayer for Jared, as he's not able to be with us, and we'll pray for healing, that he can be restored to health. Let us pray. Almighty God, you've knit your chosen people together into one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and so pass with him through the gates of death and the grave to our mortal or our joyful resurrection. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray that you would grant all who have been nourished by your holy body and blood and your Son may be raised to immortality and incorruption, to be seated with him in your heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give to the family of Clint and to all who mourn comfort in their grief, and sure confidence in your loving care, that casting all their sorrows on you, they may know the comfort of your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you are the great physician of body and soul. We give you thanks that you ultimately heal as you give resurrection. But we also pray for those who are still here on earth, especially Jared and others that we have in our mind. We ask that you would bring healing. If it's your will, do a miracle in his life that he may come through this treatment and be rejoined with his family here on earth to give you praise in your house. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, we pray also for all those who travel to this place and return home for protection on the roads. We ask that you would grant safe reunions and joyful being back with one another. We pray that you would continue to give the Utech family joy as they meet with one another. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive our thanks for Clint and for all the blessings you bestowed on him in this earthly life. Bring us at last to our heavenly home, that with him we may see you face to face in the joys of paradise. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light. We bring you thanks that by his death he destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection, he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Strengthen us in the confidence that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life nor things present nor things to come will be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we pray together the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hear those words of our gospel reading again. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Lord, now you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. Let us go forth in peace, in the name of the Lord. Amen. I'd like to say a prayer with all of you now. You're all invited, as I mentioned earlier, down to the parish hall for a meal. But let's ask God to bless that meal at this time. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Clint and all those who have gone before us in the faith. We ask that you would now bless our conversation and also the food that is shared. We thank you for it and ask that you would bless our bodies so that we can serve you all the more. We ask this through Jesus and we pray, come, Lord Jesus, be our guest and let these gifts to us be blessed. Amen. You may be seated and we'll close the service singing On Eagle's Wings. And as we sing, we'll also begin to process out and go down for lunch. In the shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow for life, say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock in whom I trust, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under his wings your refuge, his faithfulness your shield, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you the palm.